Hey, are we, Chris, are we just starting? Are we just starting the way we normally do? Eric?
Eric, we'll come.
All right, good morning, church. That was actually not too bad for none of you listening. Good morning, church. It's good to be with you guys this morning. My name is Pastor Eric. I'm the pastor at Glasstown Church in Millville. Got our people represent over here. And we also have Living Faith. The rest of you are all here. We're glad you're here too. So we're excited to be with you for our all church celebration this morning. There's a lot going on. We have a picnic afterwards. We have baptisms during the service. We have our normal worship and sermon. There's a lot of things happening. But the thing that I want you to kind of connect through that is that it's not just that there's things happening, it's that God is doing a lot of things. And so we're here to just celebrate what God's doing. He's all over our church. I see you in his life, in him in your lives. And I want to celebrate that this morning. So I want to read this verse. It's Psalm 150. If you could stand up with me, and I want you to read it with me. Before we start, here's the background of why we're doing this verse. So if God's on the move here, an appropriate response is celebration. An appropriate response is bringing glory to God and saying he's here, he's worthy of worship, he's worthy of our singing, he's worthy of our energy, our effort. And so people will continue to come in through this beginning of the service, but we have over 400 chairs set up in here. We've got lots of space, but we want to celebrate what God's doing, and I don't think there's a better passage for us to start with than this one. So if you could read this with me, read it with gusto, with the idea that you are giving direct praise to God the Father. All right? So let's read this together. Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his mighty deeds. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the trumpet sound. Praise him with the lute and harp. Praise him with the tambourine and dance. Praise him with strings and pipe. Praise him with sounding cymbals. Praise him with loud clashing cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's praise him this morning.
Worship you.
through till I met you.
Thank you. That everybody is still standing. That's awesome. A lot of times the kids are the ones that sit down and the adults stand, and we're going to reverse it a little bit in just a minute. It's a time for school, right? School is starting. It's time for the end of summer. There's a change of pace. There's a change of mindset. Sometimes school starting can bring on anxiety. Sometimes school starting brings on excitement, you know? Whatever that looks like for you, whether your face is like all excited, my name is Sarah Bates, I'm the early children's ministry coordinator. So we talk a lot, when we talk about emotions, we talk a lot about what your face looks like, right? So sometimes your face for school starting might be like, yes. Sometimes face for school starting might be like, oh, I'm not too sure. And so as we consider those things, we want to lift them up to God, and we want to kind of hand over this school year to God. So I'm going to ask that the adults, if you could sit, and any children that are going to be going to school, whether that's public school, private school, home school, if you could stay standing, we'd like to pray for you. And included in this time, even though they're in class, are you know, the five-year-olds that maybe are starting kindergarten. We'll keep them in mind as we prayerfully pray over these. Now, if you're a parent, a support person, aunt, uncle, grandparent, or somebody, look at these kids around here. Pick one or two of them and be praying specifically for those that are standing and those that are in their classes right now as we pray together. Lift up your hearts to God as I pray aloud. Dear Jesus, God, in so many areas when there's changes, it can bring about so many feelings of loneliness or just concern, God. And we pray that you would be near to these children that are going back to school, that you would be near to their parents, comfort them in how to support them, God. Jesus, that you would give them friendships, that you would give them desires to learn, that you would give them desires to be you to this school system, that you would use them, God, and that you would work in their hearts while they're at school as well as at home. Encourage and build up the parents, Father, that you would give them conversations to have to know how to connect with their kids after school about classes and anything that may come through this school year. Father, we lift up the school year to you. We together lift up these children to you. We lift up the teachers that may be impacting them. We lift up the moments that you are going to have for them, that you're going to speak into their life. Father, we lift them up to you. And we pray that you be ever present in the school system, that you be ever present in their hearts, no matter where they are. We are grateful that we have an Abba, Father, Daddy that loves them even more than we do. We acknowledge that, God, and we ask for your hold and your grip on this school year. Amen. Amen. All right, children, you can go ahead and have a seat. Thanks.
I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child. You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies till all my fears are gone. Sing it, church. I'm no longer a slave. Chosen me, love has called my name. Thank you, Jesus. I've been born again to your family. Your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer a slave to fear.
Let's pray. We are your children, God. And here we are. We come to this place as we are. We need you. We need you to cleanse us. We need you to rescue us. We don't come here after we have everything figured out. We come here because we need you to help us. Lord, we come with our weaknesses. We come with our brokenness. We come before you acknowledging your holiness, your faithfulness, your love. There's nothing on us that deserves this, your amazing love. But thank you. Thank you for your unending and new mercies every morning. And as we come here today, God, I can just but remember all your blessings and all that you have been faithful before. And we just ask you to continue blessing our lives through you and in you as you have been faithful before. That's the only thing we can witness. Your faithfulness in our lives. We can go out and say what you have done with and for us, through us. God, with that in mind, we come together acknowledging your presence in this place, your presence with us, your desire to establish yourself among us and dwell within our midst. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God, for your faithfulness fulfilled in the sacrifice and the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. And we can just wait to see you again. We can't wait just for your return. We're so looking forward to see you coming in the clouds. Here we are, Father, coming with all our brokenness and thankful for your amazing love and your amazing grace, your faithfulness, and the knowledge that you are with us. Desire that you are fulfilling in our hearts to pursue you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
I missed my cue. Sorry. Hey, it happens. It happens. That's just how we do it here. So it's all good. So, all right, I'm Pastor Chris. I'm one of the pastors here. I see several unfamiliar faces, which is really cool. So I hope I get a chance to meet you guys and hang out with you at the picnic. So it'd be a good time to hang out. So I'm going to have Diego come and join me, too. We have a couple things that we wanted to hit for you. One of the things that we most want you to do is really put your life up against the Word of God. So the way that we do that here at Living Faith is called Truth for Living. So in your bulletin, you have an insert that has all 13 courses that are going to be offered starting here in September. So I want you to pull that out. I want you to be looking that over. Before the picnic's over today, if you can jump on lfhchurch.org/info, you can go ahead and sign up for your Truth for Living class that you want to take. I set a goal for our church that we would have 50% of our church jump in one of these classes this year. So we're clicking away and getting closer to that. So I want to encourage, if you haven't taken a course yet, jump in, because this is the last set of courses before we get to Christmas. So there's some excellent things in here. We have a marriage oneness course. We're going to be doing another, it's called Change to Lead, which if you're familiar with SDI, Strength Deployment Inventory, that'll be an awesome thing. We have a study that's walking through the life of Jesus called Steps of Our Savior. We have studies for just women. We have a Bible study that's for girls from 18 all the way up to 80 that happens on Tuesdays. So there's a lot of options for you. We have a lot of opportunities for you to engage, study the scriptures, learn, process, talk. So go ahead and choose one of those. Sign up for those today. If you have any questions about that, you can see me. And then Diego's going to tell you about the other thing.
Good morning. So we're going to be available for Celebrate Recovery. In a moment, you're going to see a video clip. Celebrate Recovery is a program that will help anybody 19 years old and up deal with pains, struggles in life, and hang-ups. There's going to be different people with different t-shirts that point to Celebrate Recovery. Feel free to ask any questions. We'll be glad to interact with you. And this Tuesday, 6:30 p.m., we'll have an open house. So watch this video, and we'll be glad to talk or interact with you a little bit later.
Good morning, everyone. So my question after hearing the announcement for the classes, which there's a lot of great classes, I feel really bad for somebody who turned 81 years old this year, and they're out. Sorry. So if you're 81 and want a Bible study, then we will come see me, and we'll sort something out. We'll make sure you get included. All right, so we're going to be having baptisms in a little while. So those of you who are getting baptized, now would be your time to go ahead and go get ready for the baptisms that'll be coming up. So you can do that while I start the teaching. All right, so do I have control of this? So I have a friend, her name is Jessica, and I've known her since like sixth grade. She's actually really close friends with my wife, one of her closest friends, and she is a delightful person, but a horrible basketball player. And in high school, she decided to play basketball. I think she decided to play basketball, not because she was particularly good at it. I think she wanted something to do to get out of the house. I also think she's pretty social, so she wanted to, you know, get to hang out with people. So she decided to play basketball. But her and basketball didn't get along very well, and she didn't see a lot of playing time. But she did one day get onto the court, and she's playing, and she's doing her best, and all of a sudden, she's underneath the basket, the ball falls to her, and, you know, she gets it, puts it right back up, and she is like, I just scored a basket. And so she is celebrating, and as she's celebrating, she realizes no one on her team is celebrating, because while she did score a basket, you guessed it, she scored in the other team's basket. So the 2 points went in the wrong direction. So and the reason, you know, she was so wide open, it was uncontested as a layup, is because she was shooting in the other team's basket. So her rebound was excellent. Her technique was solid. The only thing wrong was she was missing the whole point of the basketball game, which is to score more points than the other team. And so sometimes, you know, missing the point can be funny. I think for Jessica, it's just one of her many basketball stories, and she laughed about it and has moved on. However, sometimes missing the point can have very significant consequences. Like, if you miss the point of college, right? If you miss the point of, you're investing all of this money, but you miss the point of why you're there, and you're not going to college to meet friends or gain new experiences, right? I know people who have gone to college for that purpose, and they have hundreds of thousands of dollars in debt for, you know, with no degree and some good relationships, right? So you don't want to miss the point of what is college for. You don't want to miss the point of marriage. What, you know, Nick and Erica are back from their honeymoon. Good to see you guys. And one of the things I asked at their wedding was, like, what is the point of this? And if the point of marriage is to make you happy, then you're going to go into marriage a very selfish person, right? So you got to ask, what is the point? If you come to church and say, what's the point of church? Well, it's here to meet my needs. Well, you're going to be pretty disappointed, right? Because there's going to be needs that are not going to be met. So we have to ask the question, what's the point? And so this morning, that's the question I want to ask of baptism. What's the point of baptism? And so I want to give you four statements about baptism. And as I give you these statements, I think you'll begin to see, oh, that's the point of why we do this thing called baptism. The purpose of baptism helps shape not only why we do this thing, right? It's not only about why we do this religious activity, but the point of baptism actually gives form and shape to who we are as followers of Jesus. And so if we understand the point of baptism, it's going to help us understand the point of our journey with Christ and what it means to be alive to God. All right, so very quickly, I want to move through four statements about baptism. Here's my first one. Baptism is a statement of transformation. All right, baptism. If you see people going to the back, that's the people that need to get ready for baptism. So it's not like there's some sort of, you know, leaky pipe or something like that. All right, so baptism is a statement of transformation. It's about being changed. It's about being transformed. Baptism is not primarily a religious activity. Actually, for us today, the word baptism really is only used in religious settings. Right, but the actual Greek word for baptism was a common everyday sort of word. Right, so when you hear somebody say baptism, they're making a reference to a religious activity. In the first century, right, in first century, the term baptizo would be used of kind of everyday normal life. And so baptizo, it would mean to dip, immerse, or drench. Right, so you would baptize someone or something. Right, so for example, it's used several times. We translate it not baptize in your English translations. We would translate it to dip. So Lazarus was asked to baptize or dip his finger in cool water so that he could. So the degree of discomfort, the degree of pain would be quenched if you just baptized your finger. Just dip your finger in the water, right? And that's so that's one of the ways that baptism is used. Also, it was used in John 13, where Jesus dipped the bread, and then he gave it to Judas, right? So he dipped the bread, he baptized the bread into the wine. So what does that mean to baptize the bread or dip it? You just imagine, you know, you take a piece of bread and then you immerse it into grape juice, into wine, right? It's totally saturated. Right, the actual substance has a different consistency, right? As it is dipped, so the dipping of the bread, the baptizing of the bread into the wine, that's one of the ways that's used. Or in Revelation 19:13, Jesus wore a robe that was dipped in blood, right? It was a robe that had been baptized in blood, so that robe is no longer the same. So the word gives us an idea of the mode of baptism, right? So we baptize by immersion. There's a tub up here. People are going to be immersed into the water. But I think more than the mode of baptism, this word baptizo, what it means for us is a picture of intensity. It's a picture of you can't be baptized and remain the same. Right, to be baptized into something speaks of the intensity of what that is, what is being experienced. So a boat that is baptized is a boat that is sinking. That is the intensity of that experience, or the baptizing of a piece of cloth. The cloth now changes color, right? It is now different in terms of what it appears to be like. So baptism speaks to the intensity, right? So it is a statement about something that is serious, something that is being changed. In other words, you don't experience baptism and remain the same. Baptism is a statement of my life is different. I'm going a different direction. So baptism is a sign, is a statement of what has happened to me is transformational. All right, my second point about baptism. Baptism is a statement about your creed, right? Baptism is a statement about your creed. What is fascinating is that baptism is not the first step in following Jesus. It is always, at best, a second step, right? So baptism is a statement about your creed. It's a statement about what you've already come to believe. It's what your faith already is. So a creed is a set of beliefs. So if baptism is a statement about your creed, it's you have this creed, and now baptism is a declaration of that creed. Let me show you this very quickly. It's really interesting. The book of Acts provides us with kind of a history of the first century church. So we get a series of baptisms that take place. And you'll notice, I'm going to run through it really quick. You'll notice that in every one of these examples, baptism is not the first step, right? It's at least the second step. So in Acts 2:41, those who received the word, they received the word and were baptized. Or in Acts 8:12, right? He believed the good news about the kingdom of God in the name of Jesus, and then were baptized. Or Philip opened his mouth, and beginning with the scriptures, he told him the good news about Jesus, which then led to baptism. Or in Acts chapter 9, immediately, like, there was this revelation, like scales fell from his eyes, right? So he saw something, and then after that, he was baptized. Or Acts chapter 10, there's the receiving of the Holy Spirit and then baptism. Acts chapter 16, this is about Lydia. She had heard something. The Lord had opened up her heart, all right, to pay attention to what Paul was being said. And out of that revelation, she was baptized. Acts chapter 16, they spoke the word to him, and after that was baptism. Or he believed in God. After that came baptism. Or Crispus, ruler of the synagogue, he believed in the Lord together with his entire household, and then after that, they were baptized. And then on hearing this in Acts chapter 19, after hearing, they were baptized. The clear pattern of baptism in the New Testament is that it is a sign of what is your creed? What have you come to believe? And so as you watch people get baptized today, there is a creed, a belief in God that is on display as they step into the water of baptism. So when you're baptized, you are making a statement. You're making a statement about what you believe to be true, what the trajectory of your life is, who is worth following. That's a declaration that you're making in the water of baptism. Third statement about baptism is that baptism is a statement about new life. Baptism is a statement about being newly alive. I love this verse in Romans 6. It says, "What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin so that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who have died to sin still live in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death?" Right? So being baptized into his death means you're no longer alive to what you were previously alive to. So you're baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him in baptism. You're going to see that imagery. You're buried, therefore, with him in baptism. That's the picture that's going to be in front of us. In order that just as Christ was raised from the dead to the glory of the Father, we too might be raised and walk in newness of life. The symbol of baptism, the picture of baptism, is you die to something so that you might live to something else. There are lots of different disagreements about baptism. Right, there are some churches that they will baptize babies. There's churches that will baptize through the sprinkling of water, right? So within Christendom, there's lots of different disagreements about the mode of baptism and the age of people in baptism. But one thing that we all agree on is that baptism represents being alive to God, being alive in his kingdom. That's the point of agreement. I love this quote by J.I. Packer. He's a theologian. He actually would have some different beliefs on baptism, but you can see clearly where we are in agreement. Christian baptism is a sign from God that signifies inward cleansing and remission of sins, right? So there's been some cleaning that has been done on the inside, and the remission of sins, meaning the penalty for sin has been paid. And it is a spirit-wrought regeneration and new life, right? The Holy Spirit comes into a life, and we were dead in sin until we're made alive in God by the blood of Jesus through the power of the Holy Spirit. So we are wrought regeneration by the Spirit and new life. Then he says this, baptism then carries these meanings because first and fundamentally, it signifies union with Christ in his death, burial, and resurrection. Now hear this. And this union with Christ is the source of every element in our salvation. In other words, the picture of baptism is a union with Jesus in his death and then in his resurrection so that we can be alive to God and enjoy the benefits of all that it means for us to be in God. And often, I think in baptism, we think of it as just the regeneration part, right? Where we recognize the symbol of baptism is that we have died and now we're made alive. Like it's just something that happened in the past. And it is something that happened in the past, but it has continual implications by living in Christ Jesus. So that's what Packer's talking about here, where every element in our salvation is ours because of what happens, right? Because of the picture of what happens in baptism, where we died to one way, we are alive to a new way, and living in that new life, God has so much more for us. All right, fourth and final one, baptism is a statement of identity. Baptism is a statement of who you are. So in Matthew chapter 28, the Great Commission, Jesus said, go therefore and make disciples of all nations. Well, how are we going to make disciples? Well, he gives us two ways, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teaching them to observe all that I've commanded you. And behold, I'm with you to the end of the age. So as Jesus launched his disciples in Matthew 28 with the imperative to go and make disciples, he gives them two means or two tools to do that, baptizing them and teaching them, right? And baptizing is a picture of a new identity. You are now alive to God. Notice what Jesus says there, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Now, I don't believe what Jesus is doing is giving us the script of what we're supposed to say in baptism. Right? I mean, can you think of any other time that Jesus does that? You know, when you serve communion, make sure you say these words. When you baptize people, make sure you say in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, which, by the way, as people are baptized today, that's going to be said, right? But the point here isn't just giving some mode of a religious activity that you do in a public setting. What Jesus is saying here is when we are baptized, we are immersed into a new family. We are immersed into the family of the Father, the family of the Son, and the family of the Holy Spirit. We are given a new identity. So when we come to faith in Jesus, right, we enter into all new relationships, right? We become part with God, partakers of the divine nature. We get to enjoy community with God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. That is now our new identity. Oop, I went the wrong way. Right? So because, right, because we have a Father, that means we're in a family. That means we are his sons. And not only does that set our identity of who we are, but our identity then determines what do we do. So we live in family. We live in community together. And it's a worshiping community where we are exalting not ourselves, but our dad. Right? So we're part of a worshiping community because God is our Father. And then we're also connected to Jesus, his son. We're in the name of the Son. So we have the identity, right, that is connected with Jesus. So like Jesus, we then are servants, right? It sets then what we do. And then we are part of the family, right? So we are in the name of the Holy Spirit. And as part of the Holy Spirit, the name of the Holy Spirit, we get in on the family business, which is going throughout all the world, glorifying God, exalting the Father. And we are empowered to do that. He gives us gifts because we come in the name of the Spirit. So to come in the name of someone is to come like an ambassador would. An ambassador would show up and they would come in the name of. They would be acting on behalf of, empowered with delegated authority, right, from the one who's in charge. So as we walk on planet Earth, right, as we live out our faith in Jesus, as we live out the symbol of our baptism, we come as a representative of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. That is our identity. And I love the songs that we sang this morning about our identity. That sets who we are. And when we understand who we are, then we understand what we do. So what we do is we exalt the Father. We live as family together. You see the D in the middle? That's the disciple. That's the disciple's identity, holding those things in tension. We live serving one another in community together. We live as people who have been sent. Why? Because that's who we are. That's our identity. So, those are our four baptism statements. Baptism is a statement of transformation. Baptism is a statement about your creed, about your belief. And baptism is a statement about new life. And baptism is a statement about your identity. So God is committed to your development. Like God is so concerned with you being formed into the image and likeness of Jesus. That's why baptism is not just a sign or symbol of something that took place previously, right? But it's a sign or a symbol of something that took place previously that has ongoing implications, that you are now alive to God. And being alive in Him, then He wants to grow you up. He wants to mature you. So as you watch these baptisms that are about to happen, like, I want you to look for these statements, not necessarily expressed explicitly, but implicitly. You're going to hear their testimony, right? Look for, what does it say about their creed? What does it say about their transformation? What does it say about the new life that they're enjoying now? What are they saying about their identity, of what they understand or who they understand themselves to be? So as we watch these baptisms, I want you to tune in. I want you to tune into that. Let me just close with this. This has been an odd fall for my family because for the first time in 18 years, our daughter doesn't have the same address as us. She is now in college in Western Pennsylvania. It's about a six-hour drive. I think I can do it in, you know, close to five. I could be there by lunchtime if she needs me. But it's been rough. I'll be honest with you. It's been difficult. And, you know, as is true for me, I recognize that's going to be hard. And then I don't understand why. I don't understand how. And so it takes me a little while to process. Some people have high emotional intelligence and they know exactly what's going on internally. That's not me. It takes me a while to figure out what's going on in here. And as I've processed some of what it means for Isabella to be away from us, I've realized some of the pain comes from this. That since she was born, every developmental stage of her life has led to greater intimacy. Right? So, you know, when she was first born, she was breastfed. Well, we didn't spend a lot of time together then. That was just her and her mom, right? But as she was then able to take a bottle, as she was then able to be spoon-fed, well, that meant dad could participate, right? So it led to some greater time together. Then, you know, she was able to crawl, and then she was able to walk, right? And then she was mobile. Now we could go on walks together, greater intimacy. She was able to talk, right? And first it was just little silly interaction, you know? But then over time she would develop a better vocabulary. She would, as she grew in school, she would be able to talk about more abstract things, right? Then we were able to share books we were reading, concepts that we wanted to dialogue about, right? So with each with each stage of her development, it led to greater closeness and greater intimacy until this one. Wow, I'm on the clock, huh? Very subtle back there, guys, very subtle. It's like the Oscars where my mic's gonna fade out soon. Telling a story about my daughter, it's heartless. So with each stage of her development, right, it led to greater intimacy together until this one, right? This next step was her being away from me, not closer to me, right? So we didn't have the proximity. We didn't have the conversation. And so I was grieving that, and I was sharing that with people. And Connie Jones shared with me a little bit of perspective based on her experience of as her kids went away to school, what was able to happen then is because they weren't together all the time, as they would come back, right, you would get to see like leaps in their maturity, right? And then as you got to see the leaps in their maturity, you also got to process with them about what they were learning. And they were learning new ideas that you didn't come up with. Or they were exploring new concepts, and so they were able to introduce new thoughts based on the foundation that you had laid with them, but introduce new ideas and new thoughts into your conversation and into your relationship. So that gave me some hope. I could say, okay, I can look forward to, right, even with this next stage of development, when she comes back, we're going to have some great conversations. I'm going to get to enjoy the beauty of what she's learning so that it'll continue in our pattern of each stage of her growth leads to greater intimacy with us. And I think that's the picture that God wants us to have in relationship to him. That God is so committed to your growth, right? He gives you a new identity. He gives you new life. He sets your creed. He's about your transformation, not simply because he has stuff he wants you to do, which he does, not simply because he has purposes for your life, which he does, but I also believe that what God is doing in wanting you to grow up is so that you can enjoy greater intimacy with him. That you would be able to have grow in new concepts about the depths and the riches and the wisdom and knowledge of God so that you can enjoy him more. And he can enjoy you enjoying him more. So my invitation for you is not only track what's going on in these people's lives as God has done some beautiful things and God is transforming them, but I also want you to take seriously the invitation to walk in new patterns, to live out. Maybe you haven't been baptized. Maybe the baptism course is going to be a good next step for you. Maybe you have been baptized and you need to take seriously this invitation to grow up into maturity, to keep going in your transformation, not simply because God has stuff he wants you to do, but God wants you to enjoy him more. And in order for you to do that, to grow in intimacy, you need to mature. You need to move to that next level of development. So that's why we do Truth for Living classes. That's why we have pastorates. That's why we have Celebrate Recovery, because we want to be a church characterized by living faith, where we are growing up into the image and likeness of King Jesus. All right, let me pray for us. Father, thank you. Thank you for the privilege of being your sons and daughters. Thank you for being so committed to our transformation. Thank you that you want us to grow up in Jesus. You give us a sign of baptism as a picture of we have died to one way of living so that we can live to a new way. And we can be alive in you. We can be listening to your voice. We can be walking in obedience. We can worship you in every moment. We can be alive in you. And so I pray that we would celebrate now these pictures, these very living, very real pictures of lives that are being transformed into the image of Jesus. And I pray that it would invite us to the next stage of maturity. In your name I pray, Jesus. Amen.
All right, so We have three people that are getting baptized. They're making all four of those statements today. So this is Annie Politis. Okay. We have Chip Rischel. And we have Maria Testaroni. I said it right? Okay, got it. Awesome. So we're gonna take a little bit here and hear some of their stories. So the way we're gonna talk about their stories, we're gonna talk about the past. We're gonna talk about somewhat like the present reality, the daily reality of Christ. And then we're gonna talk about the future. So, who's playing? Oh, sorry. Oh, okay, all right. I thought maybe we had the video with some dance music or something. Anyway. So Chip, I'm glad you're here, man. It's been a long journey.
Glad to be here.
A lot of talking. So tell us a little bit about life before Christ.
Well, there was a praise song we sang earlier about fear, and it's like that one was just custom ordered for me because my life was completely governed by fear from childhood. You know, it just went back. I mean, fear of everything, really. Fear of rejection. Fear of getting found out as a fraud. Fear of failure, and it led me to becoming a control freak, because, you know, fear causes pain, and, you know, I just wanted to control everything, and it led me to a life of addiction, alcoholism. I'm proud to say that through Jesus' help, I got 27 months of sobriety. Last time I had a drink or a drug was May 19, 2017, and it's amazing because that train, there was nothing stopping that train except for Jesus. I can tell you right now, I was a fifth of scotch a day, and I ate pills all day to get me through, and I was drinking at night. So to get to that point, and to prayer. Reaching out, just crying out to God to help me. And He did. Sustained me. I was a lousy father. I was a lousy partner to my girlfriend. I'm proud of where I was. But through God's help, I'm proud of where I am.
And so Jesus has kind of taken you on a journey, kind of changed some things. So what has He changed in that we call that the heart level, like that invisible place inside? What's He changed in that?
Through love. Jesus has taught me that I'm capable of being loved because I never thought I was capable of being loved. I'm worthy of that. And I know that today. So on the heart level, that's where Jesus has touched me. And through doing that, I'm capable of loving others because I was all about myself.
So what's next? You're gonna go in the tank here in a little bit, but then
I've got hope. I've got hope, and I got purpose in my life.
Awesome.
See my little boy sitting back there, Liam. Hey, Liam. I have purpose, and I'm just proud to be joining this church family, and I'm looking forward to communing and just advancing my life. Christ.
Thank you. last 2 years I've been given diagnoses. So it'd be absolutely terrifying. I'm watching my children, watching people around me. I'm watching God do things that I didn't even think were possible. I have doctors telling me I shouldn't be alive. And I'll ask him, what are you doing? How is it? And it's all him. Everything is always I get back. And everything is by his grace. And I find it so ironic that I need to share this with you because this is what I thought it was about. I come up with Psalm 73, 25 and 26. Focusing on, you know, my flesh and my heart may fail, but everything that's in my heart, it has nothing at all to do with any of it. I would do this for a
Andrew. That's your mom, right?
That's my mom.
Okay, in case we're not clear, Andy's the fifth kid. So, all right, man, so talk to us. Talk about a little bit about life before Christ.
So, I mean, I was raised in a Christian home, but I mean, been a pretty Christian God. How Christians are, you know, how I see Christians pursuing God, you know. We would go to church, but we would never have conversations or anything like that. I thought life was perfect, honestly, until, you know, my mom ended up getting sick and got in a wheelchair. And then I just, like, that really opened my eyes to, like, how broken this world really is. And I started noticing things in my family, and I just noticed so much that was wrong with me. Like, I was so angry all the time. Something that, you know, my whole family struggled with is just addictions. And although I didn't do it in drugs or alcohol like most of my family did, I took it out in other ways, things of sexual sins and things of just, you know, getting addicted to pretty much anything that I could to try and ease what I was feeling. So it was even simple things like, you know, sports or video games, like anything that would get my mind away from what I could, I would use. And just going back to anger, like anger has been one of the biggest struggles in my whole life. Like when I was young, I would like just burst out in anger. I would fight my siblings. And I didn't know why. I would just get so angry for no reason. And thankfully, like, I'm out of that. I'm out of that whole spiral and the circle of coming back to it again and again and again. And that's what my life looked like before this.
What's changed? What's happened? There's been a pretty seismic shift even in the last year or so. So talk about that a little bit.
Yeah. I've been a Christian my whole life. I can't recall exactly when I asked Jesus into my heart, but I devoted my life to Jesus when I was probably 14, give or take a little bit. And what had happened was Jesus put this like conviction on me that was so heavy that one day I came to Camp Grace during the summer, and I literally could not talk because I was so, like, I felt so guilty and ashamed. I knew that what I had been doing was so wrong and against what Jesus has for the world. It was so ungodly and so unloving. I would do the things that I was doing. And so when I got that conviction, I realized that Jesus had to be my number one. And I realized that if I didn't put Jesus first, that I was going to keep going down this road and this path that just brought me more and more down. And it brought me to a place where I would have never been able to come back. And that's why I asked these three people right here to come stand with me, because these three people have been with me through thick and thin for so long now. And I consider every single one of these people right next to me family, because they've been with me through it all. God put each and every one of these people in my life because He knows that they will always bring me back to Christ, and that they will always lead me back. Jesus has just broken so many things off me. I'm proud to say that I have been my anger. Yes, I still get angry and I'm working on it, but Jesus is breaking that off. I know He's breaking off these patterns of addiction. So many sinful natures that have just gone and lived through. And it's all because He's just so faithful and loving that He wants to heal me and protect me and care for me. And these three people have just been so amazing. I'm so thankful God uses these people to help me so much.
So what we're going to do now might feel a little intimidating for some. So what we tend to do when we do baptisms is we have a series of confession questions that we ask those in the church who have been baptized to ask these candidates. So let's go ahead and put the first two questions up. So if you've already been baptized, would you please stand? There's quite a few in here. That's awesome. Honestly, wasn't sure. But you'll see here, so we're going to ask the first question, and then you guys get to say that response. So declare it out loud together. So church, we're going to ask these candidates for this confession. So let's do this together. Do you reject the devil and all rebellion against God? Do you renounce the deceit and corruption of evil? Do you repent of the sins that separate us from God and neighbor? Do you turn to Christ as Savior? Do you submit to Christ as Lord? Do you come to Christ the way, the truth, and the life? Amen. All right. Let's get started, all right? So Maria, we'll have you go first, if that's all right. And then Chip, you can, and then let's have Andy go after Maria, and then Chip, you can jump in after that. So go ahead, guys.
Thank you. living testimony to him all the days of your life. I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. So the verse was Matthew 3:17, and it says, is when Jesus was getting baptized, and it says, "And behold, a voice from heaven said, this is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." And I feel like that's what God says over you because of Jesus, that you are his beloved Son, and he is well pleased. And then in that, in times when you feel like he's quiet or not speaking, you can count on that you're his beloved Son, and you don't have to worry about whether he's going to speak to you again or whether he's going to get you through, because he loves you, and because you're his beloved Son, he's going to take care of you. And he wants his love for you to be a secure place for him, or for you, and that love and that place of being a beloved Son to be peace for you and a sanctuary or a home for you. Based on your confession of faith in Jesus Christ and your desire to follow him, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
This is one of the many yeses you will give Jesus. And this is a good preparation. Perhaps even an hour after you come out of this little pool, you will be faced with an invitation from Jesus. And you will have to decide, will I give him my yes?
The answer is yes. I don't know what the question is.
That's great. That's great. Well, these people, including myself, we want to be available for those times, especially when giving the yes gets hard. So just remember that. And I already wrote it for you from 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. Arm yourself with the same mindset that Jesus had. He suffered, and through his suffering, he learned to live the rest of his life not for himself, but for the will of God. May God give you the grace to live for God's will. And thank you for saying yes to Jesus today.
Based on your confession, Chip, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Thank you.
Thank you.
for your freedom. Amen. Amen. Well, guys, I'm so excited to transition us into the picnic. And God has set us free, right? So I have 10 points of orientation, all right? Everybody say 10. We're gonna do this quick, fast, and efficient, all right? So here's how we're gonna do the orientation, then I'm gonna pray for us and just send us on out. So number one, if it's your first time here, we don't do this every Sunday. So number one, picnic day, all right? So it's open to everybody. Number two, you need a bracelet. Everybody say bracelet. If you already paid for your bracelet, you can exit out this door right here, and there's a little table set up, and you can pick up your bracelet if you already paid. What if you didn't already pay? Oh, that's okay. You can still pay it today. So we'll take cash, or if you have a credit card, there's iPads set up out there. So you can sign up on the iPads. Carissa and Tracy are out there signing people up. So out these doors, pick up your bracelet or buy your bracelet. It's $6 a person and a cap at $25 a family. All right, number three. I already did three. Good job. Number four, bathrooms are open. All right, don't worry. If you have to go, we have them. Number five, food court will open in about 10 minutes, so give us some time to get that open. Number six, there's open blanket seating all around, so anywhere you want to sit with a blanket, feel free to do that, chairs. And then if you see anyone maybe with like an older person that might need your chair, someone with special needs, please just be quick to give up your seat to someone who might need it more than you. Seven, we're almost done. Water slides, all right? So there's water slides, games, the drinks, all that stuff that's open right now, all right? Don't run, kids, I know you're pumped. I'll beat you out there, I guarantee you. All right, so that's all open. For the basketball, there will be basketball courts set up right over here. Just wait to play basketball till the line dies down for food, all right? We don't want anybody hit in the head with a basketball that's in line. Number nine, any other points of orientation I'll give you out there. See this lanyard I have on? It says, ask me. There's a few people around with lanyards like this. If you have questions, you can ask them and they'll help you out. And that's it. You made it through my 10 points of orientation. Let me pray for us and we'll head on out. So God, we thank you for the new life that you give us, for the resurrection life that you provide to us. I pray that as we live as a church family, we'd be people filled with your life, people who have been given new hope, new futures, new ways of living, new desires. And I pray that that would even play out today as we see each other and just celebrate what you've done in us, God. We love you and we're so grateful for your life in us. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right. Only send one person to get your name, your wristbands. Don't send your whole family. There's not enough room. All right. One person from your family. 11 points of orientation.